Bring it all into focus on Special Edition, next on Fox 59. He saw Adam Shapiro's exclusive interview with the lead witness in the Baumeister Bones case. Next, hear the latest turn in this twisted tale of murder and sex gone bad.
We had the first body show up in 1985.
Bodies in the Buckeye State had this investigator tracking a serial killer. Does the trail of bones lead back to Hamilton County? We bring it all into focus on Special Edition, next on Fox 59. Tonight on Special Edition.
I don't think that he had the means to dispose of bodies in that area. Then he gets this large estate where it provided him a means, and that might be an answer. Once again, possibly could be an answer of why we haven't had any more bodies show up.
Did he buy this Hamilton County farm to make it a graveyard for the men he killed? And is there a link between the bodies found here and a series of killings in Ohio? Adam Shapiro continues his investigation of a man who may have murdered for sexual pleasure.
Will would come home and...
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Special Edition. I'm Ginger Gadsden.
And I'm Bob Donaldson. Thanks for joining us tonight. We begin tonight with new developments in the case of human bones found buried on a Hamilton County farm.
Last week, we brought you an exclusive interview with the key witness in the Herbert Baumeister case. Tonight, Special Edition's Adam Shapiro continues our investigation as police in other states try to catch a killer.
Thanks, Ginger. Thanks, Bob. Long before police ever dug up the first bones on Herbert Baumeister's farm, and almost two decades ago is what we're talking about, the killing spree started. Now, police in Ohio want to know if Herbert Baumeister is the missing clue in their mysterious murders. When police dug up the remains of seven men on Herbert Baumeister's farm, they were able to answer some questions, but the horrifying harvest raised many more. They have yet to identify three of the bodies.
I believe we have an additional six people that we're looking at as possibilities.
Men Baumeister may have killed during a bizarre sexual act called autoerotic asphyxiation. It's a form of sexual strangulation, according to Baumeister's friend, sexual partner, and the man police call the key witness in the case.
The entire act of strangulation for Herbert would be sex. That is the climax of the situation. That's what he told me.
Did he ever talk about whether he used his hands to strangle a person?
Hands, neckties, belts, plastic bags. Very inventive. I think the list would go on.
A list investigators just east of the Indiana state line in Preble County, Ohio, are very interested in hearing.
Most of ours did die of ligature strangulation.
That means ligature meaning?
Some type of cord or device was used rather than it being manual strangulation.
Preble County, Ohio. Since the mid-1980s, investigator David Lindloff has been tracking a killer.
We had the first body show up in 1985.
A man named Eric Rodiger. His body was dumped in this ditch. Then came another body, Michael Glenn. That was 1986. And in 1987, a third body, Stephen Elliott.
We started to see this a pattern evolve that they were individuals from the same locale, frequented the same areas, and then that's when we got with the other Indiana authorities and seen that we had a real problem.
They were all men from Indianapolis. Some had police records for prostitution, and all were known to frequent gay bars. But that's about all Ohio investigators knew.
Physical evidence at the scene was lacking due to the location where it would be a rural country area, and I mean really off the beaten path.
This would be the where the body of Clay Russell Boatman was found. This would have been the last one we had in Preble County.
But not the last victim. He was found a month later in Dark County, Ohio. The year was 1990, and that year, the trail went cold. No more bodies, no more evidence, nothing.
Until 1994. That year, Indianapolis police, familiar with the Ohio murders, had a new mystery. Several missing men. And there were some similarities they couldn't overlook. Like the first set of victims found in Ohio, the new missing men were all from Indianapolis, hung out at gay bars, and some were prostitutes. Only now police had a suspect. And by 1995, they had a name for that suspect.
Later on, Mary found out that it was, in fact, Baumeister.
So Lindelof went to work. He looked for anything that would link Baumeister to Ohio. And he found it in Baumeister's business, the Save-A-Lot store.
When they would do purchasing for these stores, there was a department store in Dayton, Ohio that sold out. They had an auction. And to my knowledge, Mr. Baumeister did attend those sales. And there was some connection with an auctioneer over there.
An attorney for the Baumeister family says Herbert often had business dealings in Dayton beginning in the 1980s. But that alone was insufficient to link him to the Ohio bodies. Lindelof needed more evidence. He got it in 1996. Police were digging up human bones on Baumeister's farm, but Baumeister slipped through their fingers. He disappeared until July, when Canadian police found him dead from a self-inflicted gunshot wound. That's when David Lindelof got the phone call he had been waiting for.
And when she told me that he had committed suicide in Canada, I contacted the authorities in Indiana and Hamilton County, asking them to possibly ask the authorities to obtain fingerprints and palm prints of Baumeister in Canada.
That was crucial, because Ohio investigators had their own evidence which could solve their murders. A palm print lifted from the bridge where the killer dumped Clay Boatman's body.
I took him over to the lab in Dayton, Ohio, and have him analyzed it, and they were inconclusive. They couldn't get what they needed.
The Ohio lab needed another set of prints from Baumeister's corpse.
So I called back over to Detective Wilson. Mary informed me that they had cremated Baumeister. And it was either just maybe 2 days later, I received another call that they hadn't cremated him yet. And I asked Detective Wilson if she could get IPD evidence unit or someone to go back out and re-fingerprint him. And once again, it was inconclusive. So that's where we stand on that.
Neither enough to convict, nor enough to clear Baumeister's name. So Lindelof is now tracing Baumeister's credit cards, gas receipts, and telephone records.
So we'll take it slow and easy and do what we can to see if there's any paper trails that link Baumeister to Ohio.
Did he say how many people he had killed?
Between 50 and 60.
He said he had killed between 50 and 60.
He never said. He insinuated. I asked him how many victims he had. And their response led me to believe between 50 and 60.
There is still no hard evidence linking Herbert Baumeister to the bodies found in Ohio. But Lindelof wants to interview this man, the witness who led Indianapolis police to Baumeister's farm last summer and the buried bones. David Lindelof has waited more than 10 years to catch a killer, and he's willing to wait longer.
If there is another killer out there, I don't want him to see this interview and think I can sit back and rest now.
Ohio investigators have another theory about Herbert Baumeister. Their last victim, the body, was found in 1990. Well, Baumeister bought Fox Hollow Farm in 1991. Very simply, Ohio investigators suspect if he is the killer, then he had a new place to dispose of his victims. But that's a big if, Ginger.
So, Adam, what is next in this investigation?
Of course, there's the police work. They have to get all those records to go through. But then you can expect to see some books on the subject. And there's a documentary that's already in production that's going to air in June.
Okay. Thanks, Adam. Bob?